towards the Dover Township project. We also have another project in Morris County in Chatham, that's Chatham Borough, Florham Park, and Madison. Same technology is being used in both systems. There are differences. The difference between the two is that in the Morris County project, we're doing that project with the incumbent cable operator, Salmons Communications, and in the Dover Township project, Futurevision is the first video information provider, or VIP, as we refer to them, who will be on that network, but they will be offering their services in competition to the incumbent cable operators. We put together this this presentation. It's really geared towards a more public, low-tech kind of an audience. I'll try and answer your questions. Please feel free to ask questions throughout. But this was a presentation that we gave to the Dover Township public and to the town council to answer some of their questions, and hopefully it'll answer some of yours, or at least get the discussion going. Can we bring up some of the lights in the back? That's too dark. Yeah, that's better. Thanks. I hate standing in the dark. I know it's a little washed out, but I'd rather do it that way than in the dark. Okay, Opportunity New Jersey is an infrastructure development plan that New Jersey Bell has initiated that will totally rebuild the network, effectively, over the next 17 years. So that when we get to the year 2010, everyone in the state will have access to a digitally switched broadband interactive network. We're going to talk about how this Opportunity New Jersey plan rolls out, because it doesn't just go right there to that level of service. It goes through an evolutionary approach. And that approach really starts with narrowband kinds of services. And I know that might be a little difficult to read in the back of the room, so I'll tell you what that says. Right now we've got plain old telephone service, and we've got some intelligence built into the network, and you see the results of that intelligence through services like caller ID, call forwarding kinds of features. We call them class services. Taking that one step further, between now and probably around 1996 or so, we'll have pretty wide deployment of narrowband kinds of services that will expand what we already have today. ISDN kinds of capabilities for telecommuting, for high-speed fax, or for higher-speed data than we currently offer, for slow-speed teleconferencing kinds of capabilities. We've already started deploying that technology, and we will have probably around 80 to 85% deployed around the state that capability by the end of 1994. Wideband is the next step in this evolutionary chain of service development, and that really starts in around 1994. And here we anticipate deploying a technology that has been referred to as ADSL, Asynchronous Digital Subscriber Line. And this capability uses existing copper technology that's out there today. It'll require us to put some fiber optics in our feeder network that'll get us closer to the customer. It works on loops that are less than 15,000 feet. Now for New Jersey, that represents right now about 85 to 89% of our loops. So to the extent that we need to put some fiber in our feeder to get to that last 15%, we will do that. What this technology will allow us to do is to offer one-way video service over your copper wires while you're using, while you can use your telephone service. So it'll give you simultaneous POTS and one-way video. Right now, that video is slated to run at about 1.5 megabits, but we're already seeing compression increases and capabilities that may get that up as high as 4 megabits. So that'll give us a pretty, we think, pretty high quality video picture. Right now, the 1.5 megabits, we've done a lot of market study on. We've had thousands of people look at it and compare it to NTSC, and they see a difference, but they can't tell which one is NTSC and which one is 1.5 megabits. And both are acceptable. And that's the general conclusion that's been reached. We call it the same level quality as VHS. Here we plan on offering services like video on demand, where we've got stored programs in a digital format where you'd be able to use your telephone to access those programs and have them downloaded so that you can use them in your home. The way this technology will work is there'll be a regional, we'll call it a regional file server, that'll take those movies or events and put them in digital form. You'd access the menu, you'd interact with it and call up a movie, let's say The Wizard of Oz. That's digitally stored in a file server. That would be downloaded to your local central office, where we've got a temporary memory storage device over a high-speed line. As soon as it's downloaded there and now resides in this temporary memory storage device, it'd be free. The high-speed line and the file server would be freed up for the next request. Now it resides in the local CO, and you'd be able to interact with that. You'd have so much time to do that, let's say 3 hours. And you'd fast forward it, rewind it, pause it, just the way you could use your VCR today. And once you're done using that movie or looking at that movie, it would free up that that temporary storage device for the next request. And the movie would no longer reside there. We think that there's a lot of potential for that kind of a service for us to be able to provide video on demand types of services. Naturally, if you think about how this might be used, there's probably a lot of applications here, but the video store rental business could be impacted by this. Cable industry to some extent for premium services and pay-per-view services. We don't see this as a supplement or a replacement to cable TV service today, because it is right now limited to one channel. The last step in this evolutionary chain is broadband technology. And this is where we get to a digitally switched, interactive, broadband level of service. Video dial tone is commonly referred to in FCC terminology, where you'd be able to have a number of video information providers resident on the network, and where customers could access those services or programs at will through a switched network, also with the capability for high definition TV. We have two projects going right now, and there's a reason for that. And the first one was, and I shouldn't have switched to this too fast. The first one was with Salmons. And the reason why we did that is we wanted to send a nice clear message to the cable industry that we were very willing to work with the cable industry to find ways to provide services to them. Salmons was willing to explore that. They needed to go through a rebuild, and we needed to do rehab work in the area. So we found a nice common ground. And we will explore those possibilities with them over the next several years. Dover Township was really came about because Futurevision approached us and wanted to go forward with this, but they really saw a different approach to how to use this network. Salmons looks at this as an extension of their cable TV network with the possibility of developing new services over it. Futurevision looks at this from a different perspective, and I'll let them talk about their marketing approach and why they're going to use the network, so I won't deal with that too much, but I think you'll recognize that after they're done talking that they don't view it as cable TV, and we don't either. Dover Township was selected because we wanted to get a platform out there that was very large, fairly large, larger than what we've seen in projects going on around the country where we've had 200, 300, or 500 homes. Dover Township represents about 38,000 homes and businesses. We wanted to get a large enough platform out there to entice information service providers to want to trial services on this network. we thought that if we could make it attractive enough for them through a large enough platform, that they'd be willing to do the R&D work that they need to do and to do the market testing that they need to do, so that when we start deploying this technology, if you remember that previous slide where I talked about broadband starting in 1996, when we get to 1996, we want to have a lot of information service providers on this network so that we have services to offer over it. When I say we, I mean collectively, people using the network are offering services over it. New Jersey Bell is going to be providing the transport capability for those services. Information providers will provide the kinds of services that they think that the marketplace will demand. So in order to give them a large enough platform, we also wanted to give them we looked at some demographic issues. We wanted to give them a mix of the consumers who might be using these kinds of services. So Dover Township represented a community that went from low income to a fairly upper income type of a community. There's a very specific senior population there in senior communities, and one of the keys to this network was that we wanted to make it very user friendly. There have been you'll see some of the services that we'll demonstrate here, and you'll say, well, some of these services are available today. That's true. You'll see a lot of these services available today through CompuServe or Prodigy or other means, but those are PC-based kinds of services. And in our opinion, that market right now is about 20% of the population. Our households have a PC. A smaller percentage of those use them, and even a smaller percentage of those access those kinds of services. And there's a reason for that. And the reason for that is because they're not very user-friendly. We wanted to make a platform that would be very user-friendly. We thought the best way to do this was to make it available over the television. Something that people are used to using, something that everybody uses, and make it available through a very simple remote control keypad. Now, some people would look at that as too limiting because they don't have a keyboard. We think we can get around a lot of those issues because you don't necessarily need a keyboard. And the way we're going in the future through voice recognition services, keyboards might be obsolete. So although we don't preclude that from happening in the future, we may see a migration or an evolution of the television set to get closer to PCs going forward. We think that it's easier to make a migration from a TV set to get intelligence into it like a PC has than it is to go from a PC down to television capabilities. And we think that there are ways to migrate customer usage from the television up through PC kind of functionality. And that's really what this thing is geared towards. We wanted to trial services. We wanted to offer the platform for people to trial services geared towards these kinds of markets. If you can develop services that'll meet the senior market, and then we think that there are a lot of services that'll meet their needs, and you can get them to use it, we think we've accomplished a lot. Education was another reason why we selected Dover Township. Dover Township represented a fairly advanced approach towards using television and video in the education arena. And we thought that we could take them to the next level by putting in this kind of an architecture. We've already started talking with them. Superintendent of Schools is very interested in working with us and developing new service capabilities and how they might change the way they educate their children by using the network. Our goal is to try and do that and not create a burden on the municipality through new tax revenues that would be required. To, in other words, find the way that they're spending dollars today, just redistribute those dollars to make their education more effective by using the network. From a healthcare perspective, there's a very large hospital down there, and again, geared towards the senior community, we think that there are healthcare applications that could ultimately help drop healthcare costs. Now, whether these things happen or not, we don't know. But we think a lot of that will be dependent on the kinds of services that are developed by the information providers. We're going to make available that basic platform. How people use it and how they meet market demands is going to be reside with people like yourselves. We don't take a we invented it here attitude. At least we try not to do that. We don't think that we should develop all the services that come over this network. When I say we, I mean New Jersey Bell and Bell Atlantic. We'd like to make it robust and an open architecture so that others can be creative and offer services over it. Another reason why we did this is, as I said, we're going to start doing this in 1996, and we're going to deploy technology like this around the state over the next 15 years beyond that. And right now, there's not a lot of equipment out there that allows us to do this. There's only one equipment manufacturer called Broadband Technologies down in North Carolina that manufactures an integrated voice and video network. We needed to send a very clear message to the equipment manufacturers that we're putting out a platform here of 50,000 homes, 38,000 in Dover and about 12,000 in Morris, and that should get you interested that we are very serious about doing this for 3.5 million homes statewide starting in 1996. So we need to get the equipment manufacturers into this fray, so to speak, to start developing that equipment and get very creative in how we use that equipment to drive those costs down. So when we get to 1996, we can start deploying it at reasonable rates. Right now, the technology is geared towards aerial and buried development kinds of areas for single-family homes. The two projects, if you look at them, you'll find that there's not a lot of multi-unit dwellings or high-rises, and there's a reason for that, because the equipment just isn't geared towards that kind of an environment. We looked at a lot of places around the state, and we were limited to the kinds of areas that we could go into because of the technology. We think that's a short-term problem. Probably will be solved in the next 2 years. But for a first out-of-the-box application, we need to be able to put it in an area where we could use the technology. We wanted to have an area that had digital switches right now, and this area does. And the housing density was important so that we could maximize the efficiency of the network, and that meant that we have 6 to 8 housing units out of every optical network unit, which is, resides on the pole or the pedestal that feeds those houses. We look at Dover Township as centrally located around the state. It's in central New Jersey. If this was going to be one of the first out of the box, we wanted to have it in a central location, because if we're going to expand from here, it makes sense to expand from the middle of a hub and go out. So that was another reason. We also didn't want to do everything in northern New Jersey. We catch a lot of flack for that. So we saw that as an opportunity. And as I said before, it's a pretty good sized platform of 38,000 homes and businesses. One of the objectives of Opportunity New Jersey was that developing this telecommunications infrastructure would bring economic development to the state. We believe that. There's a lot of people out there who have argued that point. We think that will happen. We already see it starting to happen, because Futurevision is the first company to come on this network, and they plan on residing in Toms River. So there's one business that's moving to Toms River to get on this network. We think that it's natural that information providers who will want to test out their services on this network will want to locate in the area where this network is available. We think that that's natural. So we anticipate seeing some economic development result in the Toms River area as a result of that. This is not just geared towards the residential community. Although cable TV services, traditional cable TV services, will be available over it, we think that there will be a lot of opportunity for businesses in the area to find new ways of distributing their products to the residents in that area. And I'm sure Bob will cover this in more detail, because that's directly focused on his marketing plan. There's room for expansion down there because of it's pretty wide open territory. One of the reasons why we think it'll be attractive, or it is attractive to areas like Dover Township, is because it's clean industry. If new industry moves there, it's not smokestack kind of industry. It's software developers, video information providers, people like yourselves. Those are the kinds of businesses that towns want moving there. And as I said, Futurevision is the first over this network. Okay, we've got a short video that runs about 9 minutes that I'd like to show you that kind of, this has got to go to line, Rich, that kind of demonstrates the service capabilities that we see evolving over this network. Not all of these services are available over this network right now, and after you see the video, I'll try and put it in perspective as to the time frames of when these capabilities will come on. But you should get an appreciation of the kinds of services that we think will be available.
An information age superhighway, providing voice, data, and video, all through your local phone lines. A far-off dream? A vague promise? No, today's reality. The key elements of this superhighway, powerful digital switches, complex software, and fiber optic cable are being put in place throughout New Jersey today. They are being combined to create a powerful interactive visual communications network capable of delivering a wide range of information age services at extremely high speeds. A network designed to propel New Jersey into the front ranks of the information age. Welcome to Opportunity New Jersey. New Jersey Bell's commitment to the creation of this new network is set out in Opportunity New Jersey, a carefully conceived plan to expand our network's ability to deliver the benefits of information age services, whether voice, data, or video, throughout the state by the year 2010. One of the first places New Jersey Bell will be doing this is in Dover Township, where beginning in 1993, the company will replace the existing copper facility serving nearly 38,000 residential customers with a state-of-the-art fiber optic network. This upgraded network initially will provide not only the high-quality telephone service New Jersey Bell customers are used to, but also 64 channels of both traditional and innovative video programming. And within the next few years, there are plans to expand the video capabilities to provide connections to a nearly unlimited supply of video sources for entertainment and information. One of the first independent entertainment and information providers on the new network will be Futurevision of America Corporation, who will deliver a 60-channel program lineup tailored to the specific interests and needs of each neighborhood in the 38,000 home area. The in-home equipment consists of a special set-top box called a digital video terminal, DVT, which converts the all-digital network signal to an analog signal compatible with all TVs and VCRs in use today. Futurevision will provide and service the DVT, which uses one remote control to access your TV, VCR, and advanced network features, eliminating the need for complicated connections and multiple remote controls. Broadband Technologies Incorporated, a nationally recognized leader in the development of video transport systems, will provide the network equipment. Having a digital service like this allows New Jersey Bell and Futurevision to provide a wide array of new customer benefits. Let's take a few moments to discuss some of them. Regardless of the type of television a customer has, on-screen graphics, including channel display, time-date display, and menuing will be available. The menuing is accessed using the remote control that comes with the DVT. Menuing allows a viewer to select the program he or she wants without having to know the corresponding channel number. For example, if you want to watch ESPN but don't remember its channel number, you can use the menu to select it by name. And using a password option, you'll be able to control which programs can be accessed through the DVT remote control. This will be especially helpful for parents who want to control what their children are watching. Finally, menuing will allow you to program your VCR on screen using the DVT remote device. This new system will allow the viewer to instantly order new channels or special events directly from the viewing screen. The customer may even choose to preview the channel or event before ordering. And the same technology will allow you to sign on for premium channels on an a la carte basis for a day or a week, so that you can watch what you want, when you want to, and pay only for those services you use. As mentioned earlier, the new service is digital, with conversion to analog video right in the home. This technology will dramatically increase the signal quality that the new system will offer, providing both a sharper picture and more reliable service. In the future, this digital transmission format will allow New Jersey Bell to support high-definition television, HDTV. HDTV is the next generation in television quality. Viewing HDTV has been said to be similar to watching a 35mm movie with compact disc quality sound in the comfort of your home. Although HDTV is in its infancy and will require a new generation of TV sets, New Jersey Bell's new network has been designed to handle this exciting technology when it does become available. The new network also offers the ability to support interactive video applications. One of the first uses of this capability will be the ability to access video libraries. Viewers will be able to select movies, special programs, educational videos, and more from program libraries whenever they want. This network will provide a wide selection of digital quality entertainment and information without the hassle of having to travel to a lending or rental location and the inconvenience of having to return it or paying late fees if you didn't get it back on time. In the very near future, these capabilities will allow doctors to visually monitor and consult with patients and other medical professionals over the network. With appropriate monitoring equipment, nurses can check out patient vital signs while taking advantage of the ability to visually interact with the patient. And doctors will be able to share medical information like CAT scans or x-rays with other doctors to more efficiently and effectively diagnose cases. This network can also make a dramatic difference in our approach to education. Imagine attending classes at a distant school right from your home, or accessing films or tapes for a multimedia report directly from a distant video library, or working through a difficult homework assignment with a tutor in a way that allows you to see what you both are doing. Consider shopping. This new network can add a new dimension to the concept of home shopping. The ability to see and order products or talk to a salesperson from the comfort of your living room or kitchen will revolutionize shopping and be a real boon for local merchants who will be able to bring a wide array of services and products directly to their local customers. Services like real estate. Imagine entering the criteria for the home you want in a database and being able to take a video walkthrough homes that match to help narrow the number of homes you actually visit. Grocery shopping. How many families have both parents working? A trip to the grocery store can take a significant amount of time. Why not shop from home? And this service can be a real plus for the homebound who can't get out to the store. Or travel agencies. Want to take a trip or a cruise? Why not audition the trip at home with promotion programs provided by a local agency? And even the classified ad will be given a whole new level of impact. As the classified ads demonstrate, not all information services require full motion video. The digital capabilities of this network will enable a wide range of information services providers to offer their text or computer graphic services to customers either on a request or a subscription basis. The services we've been showing you are just a brief sampling of how this new network might be used. In fact, we believe that they are just the tip of the iceberg. As entertainment and information providers discover the network's capabilities, the list of potential services will explode, reaching into areas that we haven't even begun to consider. Who will provide all of these new services? Anyone with the imagination and commitment to package information and bring it to market. Just as this new venture consists of interactive entertainment and information programming content provided by Futurevision and delivered over facilities provided by New Jersey Bell, other providers will offer new services using the new network's capabilities. New Jersey Bell is excited about its new network and Futurevision's dramatic new use of its capabilities. It's a concrete demonstration of the company's commitment to bring the advantages of broadband technologies to all the citizens of New Jersey. Telecommunications plays a critical role in our state's economy and quality of life. Through the Opportunity New Jersey Plan, New Jersey Bell will ensure that the state develops the versatile telecommunications network that assures New Jersey a dynamic future in the information age.
What I'll do now is I'll run through, anybody have any questions? All right, maybe I'll take some questions now, then we'll run through how the network works. Okay.
Who's manufacturing the boxes?
Excuse me?
Who's manufacturing the boxes?
Right now, Broadband Technologies.
There's only one?
Yes. Hopefully that'll be open in the future, and we'll see a lot of CDs.
Harris was being involved? Harris Corporation?
I don't think so.
No?
No, I don't think so.
CLI or something?
No, I don't think so. Yes. Cost to the consumer is going to be dependent upon the services that are offered. And again, we're going to provide telephone service over this same network. Cost for telephone service is not going to change as a result of this network going in. The cost of service that Futurevision is going to charge for customers to access their programming is going to be dependent upon them to make that determination, just as it would be for any other information provider who wants to offer a service. Again, they need to identify the market demand and figure out what the market's willing to pay. We're going to offer these services to video information providers, this capability to video information providers, through a tariff. So you'll be able to buy out of a tariff and then market your services however you think will best meet the market needs.
The whole network's based on fiber.
This is a fiber to the curb architecture. Now, on the next slide, I'll show you basically how it works. But yeah, we're talking about fiber going from central offices to the pole or the pedestal that serves the customer's house.
Aren't you working on twist and pair using more technology before you get to fiber?
Yes, ADSL technology.
Right.
Yeah, if you remember when I talked about the evolutionary approach to get from where we are today to get to broadband, we went through narrowband, and then wideband uses ADSL technology, and that we start deploying in 94. We get pretty full deployment around the state by the 98-99 time frame. This starts in around 1996 and takes us through the year 2000. So we can't deploy this all over the state right away because it's so labor intensive and it's so capital intensive. But we think that ADSL will start to offer some of these services, and we can deploy ADSL to specific customers that want it because it's over the existing network. So if you want ADSL type of services, it's just a matter of, not just a matter of, but pretty much from a customer's perspective, they need to have the box put in their house that allows that to happen. We don't need to do a lot of rewiring in the distribution network.
You say it's 17 years before they get to fiber in the house?
Well, I'm saying we're going to start doing this around the state in 1996, and it'll take us from 96 to 2010 to rewire 56 million miles of copper.
Can you tell us a little bit about Futurevision, why New Jersey Bell chose them? What's their history of operation with this type of technology? What's the financial relationship, as much as you can say, it's not proprietary, about how much does Futurevision pay New Jersey Bell for carriage, that type of thing? How's that work?
Okay, first of all, there's no financial relationship between New Jersey Bell and Futurevision. Although the FCC in its video dial-tone ruling said that a local exchange carrier like New Jersey Bell has the ability to purchase up to 5% of a video information provider riding over this network, we have not exercised that option. And we have no plans to exercise that option in the near future. You asked me several questions. Another
why
one.
What's the background of this?
Okay, all right. The background is how this all came about.
Yeah.
In November of 1991, New Jersey Bell sent a letter. Now, we have this technology available to us in a development called Loudoun County, Virginia, in Loudoun County, Virginia, called Cascades, where we've trialed this technology. We know it works. We've done our technology tests, so to speak. So we knew we had this platform available to us. In November of 1991, we sent a letter out to all of the cable operators that operate in New Jersey, and we said we've got this technology available to us. We'd be interested in exploring ways that we could work together to, if you needed to do a rebuild, we'd be interested in offering transport for you. If you needed to, or if you wanted to expand your customer base into other areas, and you didn't want to overbuild another cable operator, we'd be interested in talking with you about this. We got several cable companies respond to that letter. That's how Sammons and the contact with the gentleman from Futurevision started. At the time, Futurevision was not an entity, not a company. They, maybe I'll let you deal with that, who they are and who, where they came from. But that's really how that contact got started. Okay. With regards to your question on charges, you asked me a question on charges. We filed with the FCC what's called the 214 application. That's an application where a local exchange carrier has to make with the FCC if they're going to provide video services. That application only would, if approved, only would give us the ability to build this kind of a network. Once we get the 214 approval, we can go ahead and build this network, but we can't sell any services on it. We then have to file a tariff with the FCC at tariff rates and identify what the rates are for the individual services, and we will do that as soon as the 214 has been approved. We filed with the 214 an illustrative tariff, but we will file a more definitive tariff as soon as that 214 application is approved.
So you're saying there's going to be new tariffs established to cover what they're selling?
Yes. Well, what we're going to sell to them and to others. The tariff will only address what New Jersey Bell will sell. It doesn't address what video information providers will sell. Okay? Because they're not subject to tariff requirements. Video information providers are not. Okay? Which is an interesting point that I probably should bring up. According to the FCC's video dial tone ruling, an information service provider who rides over this kind of a network is not considered a cable company. And I will address that a little bit further in the presentation. Therefore, they don't need to get a franchise as a cable company needs to get a franchise. Now, I think the FCC took a very forward-looking approach here in making that determination. Because we see this network being used by a lot of individual video information providers, not necessarily companies like Futurevision who package using 60 channels of service. We might see one channel providers or two or three, okay? And we think that there will be many of those. If each one of those had to go to each municipality and get a franchise, the FCC recognized that there are almost 10,000 municipalities around the country. And it would be very cumbersome for each information provider to go to 10,000 municipalities to get a franchise to operate. Also, the basis for a franchise rests on the fact that you've got something in the public rights of way, some facility. And Futurevision and others won't have anything in the public rights of way. It's New Jersey Bell's facility that's in the public rights of way. And we already have a franchise to operate in those rights of way. So I think their thinking was pretty clear. Now that's being challenged by several entities, the cable industry for one. So I don't know how that's going to come out, but that's where it is right now. Okay.
Right. The cable industry can provide these same services too, can't they? Do they have the right to provide these services?
Yeah, interesting little sidebar here. We pay, and I'll get to that, the taxes that we pay to provide telecommunication services. And these are considered telecommunication services. Video dial tone is an extension of telecommunications. We pay a lot higher tax rates for telecommunication services than the cable companies pay for franchise fees to offer cable TV service. To the extent that they start offering telecommunication services, we think they should be subject to the same taxes that we are. And that's not necessarily the case right now. So, but yes, they can offer those telecommunication types of services. And we're starting to see that happen in the Time Warner announcement down in Orlando. I don't know if you've seen that, where their Time Warner's going to do a lot of the same services that we're talking about doing for 4,000 homes down there. Yes.
Based on the current technology, how long would it take to download a two-hour program, like in that movie, that home movie search?
Yeah, from the national, from the regional file server to the temporary memory storage device that I talked about.
Right.
We're talking about minutes.
What type of device would you be using for temporary storage?
They're evaluating that right now.
You said you had fast forward, pause, and all of those functions of VCR.
Yes, that's one of the requirements that's out there right now to the equipment manufacturers who are developing that technology. So, and they've told us that they can put that kind of capability in there. Did I answer your question?
Is there any way to use satellite and microwave to bypass the fiber optic line?
Yes, but we know, well, DBS is coming, right? Direct broadcast satellite is right around the corner. In fact, Hughes is one of the big drivers there. They've said that they're going to deploy DBS in 1993, toward the end of this year. And they're targeting that service at about $700 to put a dish up on your house, about a size of 18 inches or so. But that's going to be a one-way transmission. I don't see, now this is just my perspective right now, I don't see satellite as replacing interactive or telecommunications kinds of services, at least not for the foreseeable future. There are other technologies that are out there that are starting to hit the marketplace right now. There's one called wireless cable, which is kind of like an oxymoron. And it's operating at 28 gigahertz, where they're providing, again, that's one-way broadcast kinds of channels, 49 channels, I think it's right now, where they put a transmitter in a node location somewhere in the distribution area. And then you'd put a receiver at your home and you'd be able to pick up those 49 channels. So we're seeing a lot of activity in the delivery of video, and I think we're going to see a lot of competition in this area. We think what differentiates this network from all of the others, cable included, is that, for one, this is a common carrier network, which means that this isn't a closed system. It's open to anybody who wants to provide services over it, which is not the case with cable systems today. Cable dictates who will ride on their channels, which programs will ride on their channels. So we think that that's a fundamental difference between the two industries. And basically the same thing is happening at the satellite level and the wireless video level. We think that even when Time Warner or TCI puts out 500 channels worth of video, that's too limiting. Because they're still going to be dictating the 500 channels and what's on them. We think that offering this capability to our specific area will open this up to everybody. So potentially anybody is a program provider and can get their products and services distributed over the over that marketplace. So potentially anybody who's in the Yellow Pages today offering a service, if they can find a way to come over this network to offer their service, they'd be able to do that. We don't think you'd be able to do that with the Time Warner system.
So what you're saying is that there's going to be no restrictions at all to who's going to provide services over this?
As a common carrier provider, no, there won't be. You'll be able to buy capability out of a tariff.
We don't know what the tariff is yet, though, right?
We're developing it right now. It's our hope that we can develop that tariff at a level that will encourage people to come on the network so that we can maximize its capability and its use. So we're hoping to target price ranges in that tariff that people will want to take.
Well, certainly if they're ordering a movie, they're not going to pay more than $4 or so to get it, right?
Well, we're doing a lot of market studies on what willingness to pay is, mm-hmm. because there is a certain convenience level with doing this from your home than going to the video store, taking the trip out there, not finding the video you want, settling for something, bringing it back home, watching it, and then forgetting it to bring it back the next day and paying late charges.
So based on what the telephone is able to transmit and how much time it takes, 56 something like kilobits or something like that, the telephone conversation actually takes up. you said the VHS quality is what, 1.5?
Megabits.
Megabits. So that's essentially what, three telephone conversations?
No. No. It's hundreds of telephone conversations. Again, that's a one-way transmission.
So you're looking at multiplying what the video would be times what the conversation would be, the audio time plus or towards the video time.
I don't know if I understand that.
Okay, the video. Let's say the video transfer from me to him is, I don't know, 100 conversations.
Oh, all right. Let me just clarify. This is the ADSL technology that I was talking about earlier. Right now, that technology is geared towards stored program kinds of delivery of video. That's not real time, okay? Because it's got to be, that video's got to be digitized and put into a digital format and reside on a chip.
Right.
So right now, you can't do that real time and make it cost efficient. So that technology is geared towards just retrieving stored programs.
So no video conferencing?
Not with that technology right now. They're working on how to make that happen real time, but that's not available. That's not what we're talking about here, okay? Video conferencing, we think, could probably happen at a lot lower bit rate than 1.5 megabits. We're already seeing at the 56 kilobit range and at the 64 kilobit range, ISDN capabilities will give you slow speed video for teleconferencing. And we've seen a lot of improvement in that over the last 2 or 3 years. And I think that improvement will continue. And I also think that people would be willing to pay for that kind of capability. They don't necessarily need 1.5 megabit or higher bit rates for teleconferencing.
Right, and the price would definitely have to be reasonable.
Yes. I mean, all this is geared on market prices.
Sure.
I mean, if you build $1 million Volkswagen, who's going to buy it? Right. Okay. I thought I'd just go through real quick how this, just to give you an appreciation of the network and what's happening here when people are interacting with it. Today, cable TV network has all of its channels, let's say it's a 36-channel system, has all of its channels residing at that cable converter box on top of your TV set. So basically, when you change your channel, it's like changing the station on a radio. You're tuning to a different frequency, and you effectively tune into the channel that resides there. That's not the case with this network. Let's say you're watching channel 2, and you want to watch channel 4. So you change your remote control. Now Futurevision is offering that lineup of channels. A signal goes from your remote control to the digital video terminal that sits on top of your TV set, goes to a unit called the host digital terminal, or HDT, changes from channel 2 to channel 4, and then comes back, and you now have channel 4 in your TV set. Now, this is happening over fiber optics, and it's happening at about 760 megabits, so it's instantaneous. You can't see any lag. But it's that electronic transaction that's occurring that gives us all of the functionality that we need to interact or have video information providers interact on this network. Because if you have to keep coming back to the central office in order to change your channel or interact with another programmer, you have access to that program. And you can do real-time interaction. As an example, you might want to interact with a catalog shopping service. What you do is when you go through a menu, and we'll show you how you do that in a second, you go through a menu and you pick the catalog company, and you can actually real-time interact with that catalog company and flip pages the way you flip your cursor on your menu screen. I'll show you how that might work. When you turn your TV set on, as a common carrier provider, we're going to make available a level 1 gateway. Now, this is a very generic gateway. It'll have broad categories of services. And this is just for representative purposes, not necessarily the way it's going to be, but hopefully you'll get an appreciation of how it'll work. And you might see services like education, or entertainment, or healthcare, or catalog shopping. Let's say we pick catalog shopping. Again, this would be a level 1 gateway, and there might be catalog companies who subscribe to this type of service. Now, I just happened to put these up there. We're not doing business with these companies, okay? I had to come up with some names for catalogs, and I threw them up there, all right? So if we happen to pick Spiegel Catalog, as soon as we pick Spiegel Catalog, now we go to a level two gateway, and you're in the Spiegel Catalog. Now, Spiegel is providing this service, not New Jersey Bell. Now you're interacting with the Spiegel Catalog people, and you do whatever you need to do, okay? You flip through your catalog, or you might find the product or service that you want to buy. You might have to put in some information if it's a piece of clothing that you want to put in, the size, the color, things like that, and you'll have the ability to do that. And then you'll flip to how you purchase that. Maybe it's your Visa, or maybe you have a Spiegel card or something like that. And it'll charge that card, and then they'll ship it out to you UPS. If you want a live operator come on, they might be able to do that too. That depends on how Spiegel wants to format their service. Another application might be, I think this one is entertainment, just to give you an appreciation of the kinds of entertainment capabilities that are out there, or the things that you think will happen. You might see things like movies or video information, like a TV guide for movies, music kinds of services. Interesting thing that's happening here in the music industry, we're starting to see CD players and CD recorders come on the marketplace. We think that will happen in the very near future. Because we're going to be offering this capability over a high quality line, you're going to be able to receive CD quality sound, which means that if you've got a CD recorder, you can access these kinds of this kind of music at CD quality and have it recorded on your CD recorder. And that could change the whole music industry and the way they distribute their products. Interesting little concept. Another thing that I didn't mention is that interaction that I talked about and how the network works also gives us the ability to do real-time polling of usage into nodes at levels of about 250 to 300 homes. So we can effectively see how people are using the service in those nodes, aggregated to that level. We can't look at individual households, nor would we want to, but we can look at 300 home blocks and see that 20% of the population in that 300 home block is watching ESPN on Sunday night at 8 o'clock. That represents some pretty interesting ramifications for the advertising industry and for broadcasters. Some people look at that as a negative. Others look at that as a great opportunity. I guess it's, is your cup half full or half empty? Education offers a lot of opportunities for us and for people who use this kind of a network. Here's an example of what an education menu might look like, and here's an example of the elementary school and maybe the middle school, the high school. And this one might just be a simple bulletin board. But this bulletin board might be different than what you're normally used to seeing on a cable TV system, where if you pick this one, you might go into all the classrooms in the elementary school and see, if I happen to pick Mrs. Jones' first grade class, maybe I could go and Mrs. Jones just typed in for that evening what the homework assignment is and what they're working on, what students might do for extracurricular activities to get them up to speed on the lesson plans for the day, what upcoming field trips might be occurring, so that the teacher can now send direct messages to parents who want to interact with the network and understand. I don't know how many of you have kids out there that are in school, but my kids tell me they never have any homework. So I would like to know that, right? And now they're gonna have to try and figure out a way to lock me out.
They will.
They probably will too. If they spend as much time on doing their homework, they'd be geniuses. Okay, this was an issue that was very important to Dover Township. I don't know if it's as important to you, but this gets to that issue that I talked about before, about the taxes that we pay and what cable pays today, and how the cable industry is arguing that we're not paying our fair share, and that video dial tone should be franchised in each municipality. And if it's not, the municipality loses franchise revenues. Here's what's happening in Dover Township. There are two cable operators who operate there in different sections of the municipality. Combined, they pay $134,000 in franchise taxes. New Jersey Bell pays $692,000 in franchise tax. Now, those taxes give us the ability to put our cables and our facilities in the public rights of way. Effectively, that same right is given to the cable industry for their $134,000. In addition to that, we pay real estate taxes for the property that we have use of. Where we have our central offices, we pay real estate taxes for. You can't see this very well, but the next section is a personal property tax that we pay that the cable industry does not pay. And right now, we pay about $761,000 in personal property tax. This tax is based on the asset value of the facilities that we have in service. Now, if you keep in mind what's going on here, we've got copper facilities that are out there that have been out there for many years, and they're at what we might call half-lives. They're halfway depreciated. As we go in and we replace those facilities with brand new fiber optics, we're going to put in brand new fiber and electronics, and those personal property taxes are going to go up because the asset value is going to go up for those facilities. So we're going to wind up paying an additional $555,000 in personal property tax just by us building this network. So when everything is said and done, we come out paying about $2.1 million plus to this municipality because we're going to be building this network there. We think we're paying our fair share. And we also think that as the cable industry starts providing the same kinds of services, that they ought to start paying the same level of taxes. We made some commitments to the state when we put forth the Opportunity New Jersey plan, and that is that we would work on education, healthcare, and economic development. We think that we do economic development by enticing information providers on this network. We're already working with in Tom's River, the superintendent of schools from the education side, and I'm meeting with the administrator from the hospital there to talk about healthcare services. And we've already started talking with the AARP for senior kinds of services. So what we're doing is we're forming implementation teams in New Jersey Bell to deal with these respective areas to try and make our commitments a reality. And Opportunity New Jersey begins in Dover Township. And we think it will spread from there to other areas of the state. Are there any questions before we talk? Excuse me?
What township is slated next?
We haven't made that decision, and that's true. We haven't made that decision. And we also, New Jersey Bell?
Yeah, no, who's it between with townships?
We haven't even come close to making that decision. I'll tell you what we are doing. We are in the process of evaluating the whole state and how we're going to roll out this technology. And the technology that we're using here may not be the technology that we use between now and the year 2010. We are looking at a lot of different technology applications. Our commitment has been to service capability. We have said that by the year 2010, we'll have the whole state on an interactive broadband service capability level. How we deliver that doesn't necessarily mean it'll be fiber optics. And we're looking at and exploring all of those possibilities. We are evaluating what we need to do relative to changing out our network, and that will play a role. We are also looking at the technology limitations that we've got on us right now, and that will play a role. But as I said before, we don't start deploying this technology in earnest until 1996. These two platforms are really out there to get this whole ball rolling so that when we get to 1996, there are many information service providers ready to go so that we offer a lot of services over this network. So while we may have some more of these between now and 96, we'll look at all those criteria that'll help us make that decision. Yes?
You said at the beginning of your talk that this wasn't going to be a supplement or a replacement to cable TV as it exists now.
I said that the ADSL technology, the wideband component of Opportunity New Jersey, we didn't see as a replacement to cable television.
Okay, but I would have to imagine that you're looking down the road to actually replace cable television with this technology.
No, we're going to offer video dial tone service, and to the extent that the cable industry wants to do what they want to do, they'll do it. They're going to start getting into the telephone business, to the telecommunications industry kinds of services, and they're going to do that. We're not going to stop what we're doing based on what the cable industry
right. Now, my thoughts, and just basing it on where I live right now, a community of 60,000 homes, cable has a penetration of maybe 20,000 of that 60,000. Okay. Now, when you think about cable television programming for $25 or so, you can have 30 some odd channels. It seems like everybody would have it.
But everybody doesn't have it. That's not representative of the state. Right now, New Jersey's got a penetration level of 70%, which is the highest in the country. Yeah, people of houses passed, and there's almost, I guess, Helen, you probably know this better than I. What's the penetration of, how many houses are passed? Would you say about 95% of the state have access to cable?
And it's 70% penetration of those 90%?
Of the about the 95% that have cable available to them, 70% subscribe to it. Okay, so that's a pretty high penetration.
Right. Now, I would think, though, moving the next level and having this as an add-on to your standard cable service would have to yield a lower percentage of penetration because of the dollars involved.
Well, don't confuse the two technologies. ADSL technology is that one-way video delivery service for video on demand. This is an interactive broadband service which is called video dial tone. We think this will be directly competitive with cable TV. Okay? We also think that there will be opportunities for cable TV companies to come on this network. To the extent they want to take advantage of that, they will make those decisions. Salmon's decided to do that. We think there will be others.
Because okay. they're seeing this technology moving in this direction, they might as well get on the bandwagon.
Well, I mean, that's I can't really deal with what their rationale is. They see services beyond traditional cable TV services, as does Futurevision, and if others see that potential, then they may want to come on too. As they have to upgrade their plant and rebuild it, rather than do that, they may see this as an opportunity to forego that and come on the network.
Because I mean, I'm thinking along the lines that television, since its inception, has been a passive medium. You're now turning this into an active medium.
We don't think we're the only ones. We think there are others out there who are turning television into an interactive medium.
Right.
The cable industry is trying to do that. To some extent, the satellite industry. What have the statistics been?
Have people been? Has this been acceptable to people? I mean, I would think like even like a pay-per-view with the type of boxes you can order on demand. You know, I'd like to find out, you know, what is the actual percentage of usage? Are people really sitting down and saying, okay, I want to choose from my menu now, click and order this movie? You know what I mean?
Well, we're going to find that out.
I think one of the things we lose sight of is you people are only transporters.
Exactly.
All with your demonstration here, you get the feeling that you're providing these services, but all you are is a transporter.
Did you get that impression from my demonstration?
Right. You get that idea from this.
Okay.
You're selling a service, and everybody could. I mean, the cable company could buy space on your service to provide their facilities, and they got all the cable.
Yes, that's absolutely correct. We're going to be a common carrier transporter, provider of service. The information providers are going to offer those services. Now, to the extent that that Bell Atlantic can get into that business, we are trying to get into that business. We're precluded from doing that right now. But even if we do get into that business, this will still be a common carrier network, and we still will open it up to anybody who wants to provide services over it. If Bell Atlantic wants to buy services over it, they have to buy out of the exact same tariff as everybody else. So they're not advantaged by doing that. Yes?
Is that also true with the educational system? They buy off of that tariff to be able to provide those services to the
homes? Yes. Today, now that brings up another issue, and that's the public education and government channel issue, PEG access. Bob can deal with that from what he's doing in Dover Township, but I can tell you what we're doing. As a common carrier, we're precluded from giving advantages and not and offering that service to anybody in an advantaged fashion. That same thing goes for the education community. Just as we would offer this service to Bell Atlantic at the same rates that we would offer it to any information provider, the education community would also be an information provider. And we could not give them free service as a common carrier provider. That would be discriminatory. Just like we can't give free telephone service to municipalities or to school systems. We just can't do that. But that also says that there are services, the service that I just demonstrated or talked about, where we had the bulletin board. That doesn't necessarily mean that they would buy that service and that service would cost the same as a video transport service. That would be a video text kind of service, and we see that as being very cheap transport. And that'll be a level of the tariff that we think that if there's a benefit there, and the education community can find a benefit, and they can redistribute some of their existing tax dollars that are paying for education, that they can find ways to use this network to advantage them rather than disadvantage them. That's one of the things that we're going to look at with Dover Township. And one of the nice things about that is that they're very receptive to looking at that. So we think there's ways that might change the way we educate our kids.
Are you required to offer a certain amount of public service programming?
No, we don't offer programming. You're talking again about public access channels. We make paths available for people to use. This is an issue that we have to deal with, and we recognize the social benefit of public access channels. But we also, as I said, restricted as a common carrier to what we can and cannot do. We hope to deal with this issue, and we're forming a committee of experts in this area to help us work through this issue. And it might require legislation, who knows? But we think that there are public benefits that will be served if we can offer public access channels. Or maybe there's a way that, this can be funded by the state for municipalities who want public access channels. We're open to suggestions on how this happens. We're right at the very beginning of this whole process, and we think that there's a lot of ways that it can go. Yes?
What's your plans for this nationally?
I can't talk about nationally because Bell Atlantic is a regional company and services seven jurisdictions. Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, Virginia, West Virginia, and Washington, D.C. In the Bell Atlantic area, Bell Atlantic is viewed as a leader in this area. New Jersey Bell is leading, we think, Bell Atlantic in this area. So we also think that as a result of what we're doing here in New Jersey, we're starting to see things happen. And the U.S. West announcement that came out about 3 weeks ago is a direct result of what we're doing here, because they just announced that they're going to start doing this around their region. We think others will start doing that too. So we think we're driving this train. And we have a lot to say with how it develops, because we're first. We also pay some prices for that, right? You're first in the pack, you get the arrows in your back. So,
do you have any catalog companies that are interested in coming on board, like Spiegel or Sears, right?
Well, what we're doing is we're out there right now, as I said, we're just at the very beginning. We haven't even started this capability. We are encouraging dialogue with information providers. We view catalog companies as an information provider, and we are starting to talk with many information providers. We view you as potentially some of those. We need to identify what are your requirements, so that we can make this platform meet those requirements. So we are encouraging a lot of dialogue here. Again, we're right at the very beginning, and we think that we're going to be setting the standard, and the information providers are going to help us do that. Futurevision is helping us do that. They are giving us their requirements, and as a result of that, we're configuring the network to meet those requirements.
Futurevision has 60 of the 64 channels that you're offering in this area?
Yeah, that brings me to an issue. That channel capacity opens up in 1994. When we get to sub-channelization and compression, those 64 channels open up to virtually unlimited channel capacity. Because once you have the path that goes from your house to the central office, and you've got all of those video information providers tied into that network. You can put as many information providers on that network as want to connect to it. And if you've got that dedicated path back to the central office, channel capacity, the way we think of it today, goes away. It's a non-issue.
But for now, Futurevision owns 60 to 64 channels.
They're leasing that capacity, yes.
What happens to the other four?
We're looking at that right now. We're taking requests for those other four. Because it is a limited resource, we may have to go into a queuing mechanism, maybe a lottery or whatever. Not all of the service providers who want to get on the network require a video channel. Some might just require video text kinds of capabilities, and that's not part of the 64. Video text interactive capabilities open up around this time next year. Also, you need to understand what's going to happen here with development of this network. If we get the FCC approval in a fairly short fashion, and we hope that we will, we hope that we can start turning on this service capability to about 1,000 homes a month starting in around August of this year. All right? And then do that at a rate of about 1,000 homes a month in both of those builds, the Morris build and the Dover build. So when we get to this capacity, the interactive video text capability next year, at this time, we'll still be in the middle of this build.
And Futurevision's going to be cranked up to go 60 channels by the end of this year, you think?
Well, Futurevision will deal with that. I really got to let them on because I've eaten up a lot of time here.
Regarding Salmon's cable, where will their revenues be generated from, say, in the Dover area? Where's the line drawn between Salmon's and Futurevision?
Yeah, Salmon's is not operating in the Dover area, and Futurevision is not operating in the Morris area. As that channel capacity opens up, they certainly have the ability, as does any other video provider, to enter into those markets.
So advertising advertising revenues will go to Futurevision?
Futurevision may receive some advertising revenues, but we don't think that they're going to be the only ones. For example, we might see a good example might be the newspaper. The newspaper right now is in the advertising business. They may want to come on this network and offer that same capability, advertising capability, for the same companies that they do business with today. For example, you go to a full-page Macy's ad in the newspaper. Well, maybe you'll still see that in the newspaper, but maybe Macy's will also go through the newspaper who wants to provide that advertising. Another example might be directory yellow pages. Today you go to your directory yellow pages, and that's a form of advertising. In the future, you might go through a directory on this network, and you'll see an advertisement for a restaurant. And it might have more information behind that. So you go to ABC restaurant and you'll click to it, and now you'll get advertising that restaurant wants to put on. It's not just a yellow page ad. They want to pay for more advertising revenue, more advertising space. So now you might be able to go in and see the menu for the day. You might be able to see the table layout, maybe get a video clip of the restaurant to get a feel for the ambiance. Maybe even pick the table that you want to be at and the time that you want to be there. All those capabilities exist, and you can do that through the Yellow Page advertising side of this.
If New Jersey Bell doesn't take any revenues from the information providers, I mean...
Did I say that?
Well,
no,
well
that's not
they
true.
Provide
I did?
In other words, they don't provide the services, they just provide the lines for...
We provide a service to the video information providers, and we charge you for that service.
Okay, so let's say the medical profession wants to get in on the service. Who do they pay? Do they pay Futurevision to use the channels, or do they pay New Jersey Bell to use the to get onto the?
Yes.
Yes. What?
Yes.
They
could
pay
go.
Both people.
They could, if they wanted to come on New Jersey Bell's network. Let's go beyond the next year or two and say that we've got unlimited channel capacity. All right, so that's not a limitation any longer. They can come directly to us, and that service can be available to for them to offer on our network.
So
remember all those video information providers tied into New Jersey Bell's network?
Right.
So that's certainly a possibility. Also, Futurevision could offer services to other video information providers to put in their package of services. So it could go either way.
All right, so if I'm a store and I want to get in on the shopping type of a thing, I pay...
You can come directly to New Jersey Bell, or you can go to a packager like Futurevision, right, or others. Mm-hmm. See, there's nothing that keeps Futurevision from reselling these services or anybody else. Right? Mm-hmm. You can do that. That happens today in the telephone network, too. Right? There are resellers in the telephone industry, too.
So New Jersey Bell does take in revenue.
Yes.
Other than just the Futurevision.
Yes, we charge Futurevision, they in turn charge their customers, okay? We will charge whoever is going to buy out of that tariff. That tariff, when I said that tariff, that implies that somebody's buying a service from us. It gives them that transport capability and that interactive capability.
So really there's New Jersey Bell, and then there's a concept of a packager. It would be somebody who'd be interested in buying space or channels, whatever, and then there's information providers. Information providers could either go directly to New Jersey Bell, or they could go to a packager who has some concept and means of producing what they want to do.
Yes. Yes, that's correct.
Now, how does a packager or provider, exactly what's the procedure for getting access to the system? And would we be able to do it locally, regionally, or statewide if we want?
Okay, well, right now, this is limited to where we've got this capability, in the Morris area and in the Dover area. Ultimately, as this network develops, you'd have access to customers who reside in those areas. So
a packager or provider could pick a local community, or say, look, I'd like to do all of this in North Jersey.
Yes.
Or I'd like to just do Atlantic City.
Yes. Yeah. You can have that. You can have that capability.
And you would just have rates. When you say tariff, well, that's just how it works for rates?
Yes. Well, it also, it covers terms and conditions. I'm sorry, I'm so used to living in the regulatory world that I just assume that you understand what tariffs are. Tariff is an agreement with the regulatory agency that we will operate under certain terms and conditions at certain rate levels, which be part of the terms and conditions, for service capability, service quality, reliability, warranties, things like that, and rates that we charge. And it says that regardless of who wants to buy that service, will be treated the same way throughout that tariff. So it guarantees that everybody who buys out of that tariff buys at the same level. We wouldn't. It's a non-discriminatory access to the network.
Right.
Okay.
So if someone came to you and said, "I want to get access to the system," what would be the procedure?
Okay. Right now we are. As I said, the very infancy stage here, we're trying to identify requirements from information service providers who think they've got a product to deliver to the marketplace. We need to talk with you to find out what your requirements are. You need to understand what are the capabilities of this network and how it works. And once you understand that and we understand what your requirements are, we can see if that we meet your needs. And if we don't meet your needs, we can look to configure the network to do that, and then you would buy out of this tariff to satisfy those needs. So here's what I would suggest. I've got brochures up here to kind of talk about Opportunity New Jersey. On the back is my card. I would ask that if you think that you've got services that you'd like to explore over this network, please write to me. I'd ask that you write to me. Because I probably won't be the one dealing with that request. If you call me, I'm never around. So if you write to me, I can get that request to the right group of people. Give us a little information about the type of service that you think it will be, and we'll have somebody contact you to start dealing through all those issues. Okay. Ultimately, as soon as we get approval for the 214, we'll issue a tariff. But that tariff will evolve over time based on the kinds of capabilities that providers will want. So we'll see that change. Let me cut this off so that Bob has a chance to get up. I'll just take two more hands up.
How does the information get back to the information provider?
The information that the customer's requesting. Remember, we had this menu of services up here. When you become a provider, you come on this menu. What we are making available is the access to the menu from an information provider's point of view and the access to the menu from the customer's point of view, so that once you go through that menu and you connect with that provider, it's that provider who's offering that service and that, you know, whatever that service is. So as I gave you that example before with that restaurant, it's the restaurant who programs their service for the day of what their menu is. So anytime you access that, you'd be into that program that they made available.
So it'd be almost like a phone call in the restaurant.
Kind of like a phone call, yeah. And Helen?
Is there a provision in your approach to things for a VIP to come to you and say, I want access to your system, but I don't want a whole channel. I want maybe Mondays at 2 o'clock and Sundays at 8 p.m. Can you, as New Jersey Bell, give out that kind of divided channel?
Right now, I'd say that we could not. We just haven't developed the tariff that way. That would be a situation where you probably want to talk with Futurevision or others like that.
We're going to have to break for lunch.
Yes.
So.
Yes. Supposing, as in one case that we know, I am a provider on a nonprofit. I do not want identification with any commercial entity, including, I'm sorry, Futurevision. Is that not possible?
That would be a public access channel that we're talking about.
Well, something like.
Well, that's one of the things that we're going to be working out in this this public access committee. How we deal with that kind of a situation. Is there a demand for that? I don't know. But if there is, how do we deal with that? That's an issue that we have to, that we have to address.
Is that type of service available? Computer people can do large bulk transmissions of information.
That's
available.
Hank.
Yeah.
Per day,
how much?